Welcome to Edinburgh Culture Conversations. Welcome everybody and thank you for joining us. My name is Janet Archer. I'm the Director of Festivals, Cultural and City Events at the University of Edinburgh and I'm your host for this evening. So a few thanks before we begin. Thank you to everyone at the University who's helped make this series happen, especially the Festivals, Cultural and City Events team and also Katie Cumble from the Research Centre Support Team at the Edinburgh College of Art, who's helping us out tonight. And a special thank you to the artists, creatives, academics and cultural leaders who are contributing as panellists across the series, which forms part of the global debate on how to make sense of culture in this time of coronavirus. Thank you too to the Edinburgh Futures Institute, who are our partners for this event. EFI is all about bringing people together to solve global challenges and build a sustainable future, vitally important before COVID, but even more essential now. And thank you to Donna Jewell and Greg Calhoun from Just Sign, who've joined us for the series as our BSL interpreters. All of the previous events have been uploaded to our website if you want to watch them, and we'd be interested in your feedback. You can contact us on festivals@ed.ac.uk. The series is taking place against the backdrop of the world's biggest festival city, successful because of its extraordinary community of festivals, large and small. 2020 is the first year since 1947 that the spring and summer festivals haven't been able to take place. It's felt important to mark this moment and capture how the arts and creative sectors can help society recover from the effects of COVID-19. This year, people from all around the world have engaged with the festivals in a different way through an impressive range of online work. While it definitely hasn't been the same as the live experience, audience numbers have been impressive and there's much to build on. I want to give you a heads up that the Edinburgh International Festivals platform will feature two newly commissioned EFI artworks by Anna Riddler and Caroline Sinders and Jake Elwes. The programme's been curated by Chancellor's Fellow Drew Hemant and explores the boundary between the real and the artificial. The work will be launched on the 17th of October and available to view until the 30th of November. So tonight's conversation focuses on data. Questions we're going to discuss include how do the creative industries use data? Data is much more than just technology. How is data being used imaginatively by people working in culture and the creative industries? Are there new ways that data could be used to open doors to future opportunities? And this context is important to us at the University of Edinburgh. Together with Harriet Watt University, we're delivering data-driven innovation as part of the Edinburgh and South East Scotland City Region deal. We're using world-leading research and data and analytics capabilities in partnership with public, private and third sector organisations to improve products and services, transforming the city region into the data capital of Europe. Alongside this, Creative Informatics is an ambitious research and development programme which aims to bring the city's world-class creative industries and tech sectors together, providing funding and development opportunities that enable creative individuals and organisations to explore how data can be used to drive groundbreaking new products, businesses and experiences. I'm delighted that Professor Chris Speed, who successfully established this programme, is here with us today. And I also want to give a plug to the University of Edinburgh's Business School, which runs courses such as developing a data-driven creative company, a bespoke course for the creative sector, which is running from the 23rd of September to 11th of November. And it's designed to build your data knowledge and develop confidence in handling your own data. So I'm joined today by an inspiring group of experts who will explore the role that data can play in culture and creativity. Wayne McGregor is unable to be with us this evening due to a last minute change in his schedule. However, I'm delighted that Ben Cullen-Williams, who's a long-standing collaborator of Wayne's, also an alumni of the university, has been able to join in his place. And we've got a special treat this evening as most of our panelists are going to share a glimpse of their practice with you. So, before I ask the rest of the panel to introduce themselves, I want to flag a couple of housekeeping points. I'd ask you to save your questions until about halfway through. I'll do my best to take as many as possible, but I'm sure I won't get them all in. So please do forgive me if I don't manage to answer your question. To ask a question, use the Zoom Q&A function and you'll find it at the bottom of your screen. We're recording the event, so please take that into account in asking and answering questions. And if you want to tweet, use the hashtag UOE Culture Conversations. That's UOE Culture Conversations. And be aware that the university's approach to ethics means that we're guided by the principles of dignity, respect for others, integrity, objectivity, and openness. And I'd ask you to present questions in this context. We will reserve the right to remove questions if they don't fit within this. So now I'd like to welcome my guests for this evening and ask each to say a few words about themselves. And I'll start with Professor Chris Speed.
Hello, good evening, folks. My name's Chris. I lead the Institute for Design Informatics, in which creative informatics is a project. And simply put, it's a collaboration between a design school and a world-class school of informatics, where the study and the flow of data is all part of how we understand what we do and what we mean in a digital economy. Thanks, Janet.
Thanks, Chris. And I'll move on to Mike Chappell, who's joining us from Perth, Australia.
Yes, that's right. Thanks so much for having me. I'm Mike Chappell. I have a company called Culture Counts, which evaluates the various types of impacts of arts and cultural activity on the communities that they serve. And it's a great pleasure to be joining you from Perth, where it's dark outside, as you can see.
It's a great pleasure to have you with us, Mike. And let's move on to Beverly Hood.
Hello and evening, and thanks also for the invitation to join you tonight. So I'm an artist and I'm reader in technological embodiment and creative practice, and also director of research in the School of Design at Edinburgh College of Art. My artworks that I make use digital media and performance to try and explore technology, science and the body and the relationship between those and the lived experience of those. And I do lots of collaboration with scientists and technologists and medics.
Thank you, Bev. And let's move on to Asad Khan.
Hello. It's so great to be here amongst you all. I'm a computational designer and architecture researcher. Currently, I'm pursuing like a practice-led doctorate at the Edinburgh School of Architecture and Landscape Architecture. I've got some abnormal curiosities. For quite some time now, I've been like exploring a specific class of scientific statements termed as existential risks or X-risks. Extra statements indexes the extinction of like a planetary originating intelligent life, or the permanent annihilation of its potential for desirable future development. I use remote sensing, astronomical imaging, machine learning, forensic science, computational simulation, robotic fabrications. I usually create like data visualization, cinematic installations, and documentary animations. My projects are like, they isolate this sort of synthetic world, a movement where we can explore in like the different forms in which humanity can contemplate its possible extinction. Thank you.
Thank you, Asad. And I'm going to ask you to begin in a moment when we've introduced Patricia and Ben with showing your work. But let's move on to Ben, because you've got something in common with Asad.
Yeah, well, I studied on my undergraduate architecture degree at Edinburgh University, and now I'm an artist based in London. And my practice consists of sculptures, kind of large scale installations, photography, and video. And in my work, I try to kind of explore mankind's relationship to the world in this kind of increasingly changing environment. I'm especially interested in kind of issues such as the in-between on a kind of a global scale, a local scale, and also a personal scale. Also recently, I've been investigating more about how related spatial typologies can be understood as a physical manifestation of our own human condition. Often I like to do collaborations with a whole kind of range of people, and see one of my collaborators who invited me a few years ago to work on a piece of his is Wayne McGregor, who I'm standing in for this evening.
Thanks, Ben. And interestingly, this whole concept of the space in between has come up at least once before in this series. Be good to unpick that a bit when we get to our conversation. But let's introduce Patricia Wu.
Thank you, Janet. Hello, everyone. First of all, I'm very glad to be joining you all here. So I'm a fashion designer, researcher, and I'm currently undertaking a doctorate at the Edinburgh College of Art. And in both my research and practice, I'm looking at the concept of the Anthropocene, the current geological era in which human activity has been the dominant force on the planet, And so I design conceptual and material fashion objects using data, computational simulation, digital fabrication, and I navigate with their procedures and their demands to create special forms of design protocols. And a lot of my work is in the form of fashion wearables, hybrid installations, and moving image, which for me serve as a kind of site for thought to challenge local constraints on our knowledge about our bodies in the Anthropocene.
Brilliant. So there's a lot to process there in all of your presentations. But I'm going to start by letting us look at some practice. Asad, do you want to introduce your piece that you brought to show this evening?
Yep, sure. I think it was, sorry, I'm just going to... it was like 2005 August, one of the deadliest cyclone in the history of like America. Hurricane Katrina kind of like swept away across the Gulf Coast and causing like cataclysmic catastrophes. And I think like 3 weeks later, there were like several teams. One was from like NASA, the other was from like USGS, and they started using this sort of apparatus, which is called a light detection and ranging LIDAR scanner, which uses kind of like a beam of laser that computes and calculates distances. So they wanted to see how much damages were caused by the cyclone in several suburbs in New Orleans. So they created this sort of archive and they deposited this archive online. And in 2017, I guess, I started requesting them to be able to see what was in it, like what kind of conditions of the cyclone can I see, or images of annihilation and destruction in a way. And I started working with this and converted it into a moving image using like artificial intelligent algorithms to determine like camera paths and cinematographic routes to kind of narrate and curate this archive, but also from the point of view of this sort of like inhuman eye that is no longer human, and that is kind of oscillating the dance of agency between the human and the inhuman in a way. So I think, yeah, you can play the moving image and I can join in the conversation a bit later. But usually like what I do is I use like remote sense digital archives. They're retrieved from this sort of accidental megastructure, which is like comprising of orbiting satellites, synthetic constellation, terrestrial sensors, and so on. And all of these like remote sensing technologies, they use like these sort of envoys, which are amplified photons and infrared waves and sonic emissions. And it kind of quantizes our world into this finely grained informational geography. And if we consider like every surface in the universe as kind of like it has this affordance, this as a receptive sensor, which can register and collate traumatic events in the form of like inside scars or physical changes. And then these remote sensing technologies can actually accrete them into numerical particulates and can suspend them in a limbo free from like the ravages of time or weathering and stuff. So I treat these sort of archives as like data fossils more generally. Maybe it's not this one.
I think we've got Patricia's work, haven't we? Is that right?
Yeah.
Shall we pause and just bring Asad's work into play? And we'll look forward to that one.
Yeah,
so we got onto data fossils.
Yes.
I love that idea.
Yes, I kind of treat them like data fossils, which we can mine, and sometimes like I exhume them like an archaeologist, and sometimes I work like as a practitioner, I work like a surgeon who's performing autopsies on these sort of like, you know, numerical bones, and I'm kind of like curating their stories, what actually happened. And sometimes I like induce virtual time into these data fossils to unwrap them from this warped state to create like new forms of digital spatial temporalities. And in this sort of like way, it abducts our creative reasons towards these sort of like alien environments, which are foreclosed to your like perceptual understanding of how we see catastrophe as a, so this is the moving image I created as a result of this process.
Beautiful, sir. Thank you so much for sharing that. There's an incredible sense of trauma leaving a mark on landscape and the fragility and vulnerability of our environment. That was very beautiful, moving.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So just tell me before we move on to the next piece, how did talk us through how you use data to create that work?
What I did was like I had access to these large big data archives, which were in the form of like files, and it had like numerical coordinates in it, like XYZ values. Some of them were collated on ground by a huge amount of like USGS, United States government surveyor teams, and some of it was like taken by satellites. So what I did was I kind of mapped all of those data together to create like a huge 3D model, which was at the size of like 100 gigabytes or even more than that. And then I programmed like this sort of shortest path algorithm, which is what Google Maps uses to calculate the shortest distance from one point to the other. And I trained, I usually work with the AI in terms of like, I treat these algorithms as kind of like children. So I've named them. So one of them is called Kanzai and the other is called Hitoshi and Akira and all that. I don't know why they are Japanese, but then I treat them like feed them with catastrophic archives to see what kind of intelligence breeds on them, how they navigate through a landscape. So sometimes the very points, the very data sets determines the path of the camera movements in a way that the data set is kind of co-contingent upon how it wants to be seen, how it wants to be curated. And this sort of like process is more to do with the fact that that I'm more generally looking into how these AI algorithms, like machine learning algorithms, precisely dreams or hallucinate, or how disobedient they are towards the artist agency, but are more ingrained towards the data sets themselves, which is very interesting for me because it overthrows my my rational agency as a designer, my sapient creativity in a way. And I think this is something to do with how every creative thought labors to liberate itself from the tyranny of the designer or the artist. And that's why it always takes these sort of like ontological different forms, like sometimes like in the work, in a painting, sometimes it comes up in film or dance. But in order for creative thought to liberate itself from its material entrapment, from the human finitude, it must first, I think, manipulate the very material that holds sway over it, which is the human condition, which is this sort of like a carnal flesh and these the brain, the bi posture of the human animal. So that's why I precisely look at AI to deep dream these sort of archives to narrate a differential wave of catastrophes outside the purview of human perceptual cognition. Yeah, that's about it.
Thank you. Did you know that you're a poet as well as everything else? Your use of language
is very hard. Yeah, it's really hard to be, yeah, it's really hard to be a poet and like, you know, a researcher at the same time. So
I'm gonna move us on. We've had a glimpse of Patricia's Wu's work. So Patricia, will you just give us a few words about your practice, building on the things that you said, also focused on the human condition? And then we'll watch your excerpt.
So the work I'm about to show is called The Dust Enforcer. And first, there's a philosophical counterpart to the work, which derives from philosopher Reza Negrestani's book called Cyclonopedia. I won't go into too much detail, but overall, he's also kind of reimagining the landscape of the Middle East through the lens of fictional entities. And so I was particularly interested in the use of fiction as a form of speculation about the body and how I could reimagine what we see or think about the body beyond the likeness of the physical appearance, and how I could use that as a gateway to stimulate new conceptual material manifestations. And there's two components to this work. First is a 3D printed mask, which I have made from using LiDAR. And then I have retrieved that data and simulated that into a 3D printed mask. And then there is a performative element where I'm also wearing the mask and using LiDAR again to kind of capture my choreographed movements. And there's also different materials that I was exploring to kind of refract LiDAR's emission of light into disoriented positions. So usually the purpose of using LiDAR is to capture its target through precise measurements. But for me, it was more not to reproduce the data, but to kind of deviate from the original function and to really kind of explore different layers of obstruction that are sent to the path of the scanner, and also how to harness different contingencies in working with such technologies in a subversive manner that can allow me to create this emergent co-composition of forms between me, the scanner, and the materials at play.
Brilliant. Thank you, Patricia. So, Katie, can we have a look at Patricia's work?
Thank you.
Beautiful. That's extraordinary. It's just an incredible sense of humanity, and that's a wonderful sense of how the translucency, is that a word, of your sculpture just draws you in, and quite extraordinary to witness. So let's move on. We've got a theme running tonight clearly now, which is all about the body and that push and pull between technology and physicality. Beverly, can you talk a little bit about the work that you're going to show this evening?
Hi there. Yeah, she was so the work that I'm showing an extract from is called Immobile Choreography, and how it was initiated was a commission through Grampian Health Arts Trust and the University of Aberdeen's Biomedical Physics Department. So they were working on a large scale, it's Horizon 2020 funded project, which was developing the next generation MRI scanners, FFC, which is fast field cycling, which changes normally with MRIs, the magnetic field would be fixed. And with FFC, they realized that you can get more data if you could actually change the magnetic field. So this was as part of their public engagement funding that I was then commissioned to make this new piece of work. And it was going to be located specifically within the Sutty Art Space, which is a really interesting, unusual gallery that's sited in the middle of the Aberdeen Royal Infirmary. So it's also got specific sensitivities to the space as well, in that the vast majority of the people who go there are either patients or people visiting patients. So it's a very unique context for a gallery. And so the way I approached the project was how I often would. So it's very much in collaboration with the scientists, in this case, the biomedical physicists, and actually spending quite a lot of time observing their processes and the technology that they're working with. So in this case, it was involved me going through the MRI process as well. And what I was very interested in was the experience of that, there's contradictions inherent with it, which is that there's a stillness required, as anybody who knows who's been in an MRI scanner. There's a stillness that's required in terms of you really must be completely still in terms of it, but actually the amount of movement that's happening within the body at that moment. So the process of it, the magnetic field that happens, basically aligning all the protons in your body. So actually that your whole body becomes into alignment at the time when you're completely still. And I was very interested in the idea. I mean, this is very much following on from what Asad and Patricia were saying. It's really about making immaterializing the material body into a data set. So that process of the MRI, but also there was lots of layers that I was interested in and how it did that. So the actual physical cavity itself that you're located in when you experience, which some people find very problematic and has a very limited space. And also the way that the MRI itself works and the relationship with the body, which is completely imperceptible, which is the way that the radio frequencies then are pulsed within the body, and then that the cells are then, it's the principle of the relaxation time, which is the time it takes for the radio frequencies to return back to the equipment, that the different tissues and different pathologies in the body take longer. But I thought this was a really interesting choreographic potential principle, both with the physicality of the space, this limited space, the idea that you're immobile, but actually your body is not immobile, it's completely in action at that moment, and this pulsing relaxation time. So what I did was I made a piece which, it's not so much in terms of what Asad and Patricia have done where it uses the data directly, but what it does is it refers to the principles of that. And what I thought about was, also with MRIs, there's a lot of work that exists that already use, and a lot of really fascinating work that artists have made over the years that use MRI, the look of it. That's a very sort of established look. And I was actually looking for something different that would refer to a scanning process, but would look not directly as MRI scanners. And also for me, there was an element of trying to make it more, in some way, poetic in a different way, and separating it from a direct medicalization of the body, because realizing as well the audience going into this space, no matter how attentive the health system staff might be around you, you go into a hospital space and you're medicalized. So it was trying to create something that was a more poetic space for people to go in that would refer to those processes but take it somewhere else as a point of reflection. So what I did was I worked with a dancer that I've worked with for a number of years, Freya Jeffs, and we then developed three sequences of choreography which were based on the parameters of the space, this relaxation principle, which was basically we developed movement sequences which would, in theory, fit within the cavity of the MRI scanner, and that then they would work in pulse motion, which fit with the relaxation time principle. So there were three pieces of movement were developed, filmed, and then processed, which refer to the three developed for different forms of coils, which are the coils that you wear when you're in the MRI. So it's the head coil, the breast coil, and the knee coil. And each of the movements are hinged to the coils, because they are actually then the crucial part of your body that has to be completely still, whereas really you do have to be still. But in an imagined way, it was what was possible as imaginative, poetic potential of what would actually be possible within the parameters of that space. So the choreography was developed as a combination of movement that was developed specifically with Freya, edited together, and then sort of extended and pushed further through a process of animation. And the final, it was developed as an installation piece. What you'll see is one of the sequences of the video footage, which was projected on the floor and the walls. So there was the three, the head, the breast, and the knee coil footage projected around the space. The sound you'll hear is the sound of, and it's the pulse, the beat of the FFC MRI, which is reassuringly for anybody who's been an MRI, it's much, much quieter, infinitely quieter than the normal, very, very loud mechanical noise. And then what was also exhibited in the space was also the actual coils themselves that the biomedical physicists had developed for the MRI as well. So it was a combination, and I quite often do that, where I quite often use some of the actual scientific real world materials within exhibitions as well. So that's the head coil sequence that'll be coming up.
Thank you. And I like it that you use that word reassuring. I had a little look at your work this morning, and it seemed to me that it did give a nice sense of reassurance about that experience, and a poetic experience that was very reflective. So let's have a look at Beverly's work.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you. Really good. So I'm going to move this conversation on to some of the other things that I've been thinking about at least. And Chris, I'm going to ask you, what do you think the opportunities and challenges for creative businesses are through data-driven innovation? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, I'll try to do a segue as well, because I think what you've been watching is artists, creatives, designers designing with data. I say with because a few years ago, an old pal, the late Professor John Oberlander, wrote a paper with myself around a way of helping us all think about working with this material called data. And I think I use the word material because some people treat it as a material: wood, metal, ceramics, plastics. And clearly we can see three artists really getting stuck in with a sense of materiality. But John was very sharp on Latin and always wanted to ask questions using the ablative framework, which asked us to say, when are we designing or creating from data? When are we designing it with data? And when are we working by data? From might be when we get to talk to Mike, actually, because in some ways, I think Assad certainly went from data, a data set which was, by the look of it, 15 years old, dove into that data, and it was fixed. It wasn't live in any means. And then by mediating it, he makes it live. And of course, that archaeological piece asks questions around the trauma as we look back over time. I think on other occasions, there's evidence that we're designing with data through all of the three people's work. And I suspect when we get to Ben's work, we'll find the with, because it remains highly live in real time. The by is interesting though, but the by also speaks of the algorithm, by something, as opposed to, you know, by Janet, by Chris, or by the algorithm that is performing actions within a data set. So I think, and from with by really helps me, because some artists don't ask questions to, forgive me, where the data's from and what the ethical implications are. They grab, go back to the studio, and we do need to be sensitive. But when we think about companies, they really do need to design from and where possible with, because it allows them to change their business models, adapt to what audiences are thinking. And it's in this continuum we decide the time. From could be quite old, right? It could be, I'm going to design from last year's festival data. It could be with and very fast. And I was minded to think of the comedians and the theatre folk who couldn't come to Edinburgh this year, but would have been working through the spring on rehearsing, trialing out when an audience laughs, reconfiguring their show all the time, designing from the audience feedback, but with it. And then, of course, a 20-day run in Edinburgh. So all of the time, I think creatives are very good at designing from, more so with when it's live. And then we're just beginning to learn how to use the by and how we start thinking about that. If we acknowledge that's a condition we know quite well, the question then is, how do we change the business models? Because to find success and survive post-COVID or during COVID, we're going to have to use those three phrases very carefully to find the new models, really, that capture value, if that makes sense.
That I would concur with that. And just for those people in the audience who aren't wholly clear what we mean by data, what constitutes data in the arts and creative industries? Is it everything, or are there definitions that categorize different types of data? What's your view?
I think there's lots of forms of data, and I think what we're talking about here is ways in which instruments have gathered insight from the world and placed it within data sets. Data in some ways is just a way of knowing the world, and it informs feedback loops to allow us to make informed judgments. Much of those for our lives have been analog, but once we introduced digital instruments, then we would be able to store them, use them as memories, use them at vast scale. And of course, when you apply an algorithm amongst a data set, which might be as simple as numbers, but it might be pictures, it might be faces, then we ask questions around who wrote it, what that data set is doing, what biases are in that data set, and then we begin to understand its potential to offer insight if we ask it certain questions, or we have to acknowledge its problems. because not eight, very few data sets are wholly inclusive, if that makes sense. But for me, it's data sets, it's collections of data. And whether those are streamed in real time, or whether they're perhaps gathered through questionnaires, through interviews, through photographs, which might be frozen and then brought into studios. I hope that makes sense. It's a hard question.
I like hard questions.
No, it's a simple one. But...
So I'm going to play that question out a bit, actually, and just ask Mike, in your world, what constitutes data? And then, Ben, I'm going to ask you the same question in a minute.
Well, I'm an economist, so I have a different, but not entirely unrelated view of what data is. The data context that I'm going to present in my short video really talks to the integration of audience feedback into programming decisions and other information sets that arts administrators, arts organisations and artists have at their disposal. To understand and really create narratives to explain the impact of their work on their communities of interest. It's about language, really. There are algorithms that we use in our work, to interpret open-ended text comments that people provide through surveys and identify themes within those and then cluster the pieces of feedback around those themes, and the interaction between the AI and the researcher is the researcher can select certain themes, and then the AI will go and find terms that are synonymous with that particular term. So it enables you to view the feedback from a multiplicity of different lenses. Investors in arts and culture find this work very interesting because it enables them to guide their funding contributions by the outcomes that it might present. And then those outcomes are not just cultural outcomes, they're social outcomes, they're economic outcomes. And in this time of otherism is the way that I explain it, where there are these divides between different groups of people, artificial or real, finding out what draws us together in community is increasingly important, and then being able to articulate that. Many artists find it useful to have this feedback because they need to understand the connection that they are actually achieving with their audience. It's useful for them in artistic collaborations as well, between communicating between themselves, other artists, boards or management that they might have, those creatives if they're in larger organisations. And finally, I think the audiences appreciate the language of evaluation because it gives them a platform for communicating what can be some quite difficult and nuanced language. And I've just been so impressed by the way that each of the artists who have presented their work today is able to articulate what the work means to them and what their motivations were and their methods. But often audiences and the general public don't have that that language. So we like to provide them with a platform and introduce terms that can help them to explain to themselves and to their friends and how they experience the work.
So that's really interesting. So that's linguistic analysis as opposed to statistical analysis.
Well, it's both. Yeah.
Or both, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Fascinating. There's normal, you know, SurveyMonkey type analytics in there as well. But we find that the most use that the data is in helping to elaborate and give foundation to the narratives that people use to describe their own work and the narratives of their audiences and their investors understand about the outcomes, the multiplicity of outcomes that their work can generate.
Interesting. So Ben, moving on to you, what constitutes data for you in your world?
Well, I guess I I see data as kind of, it's a kind of any input, really. If you think, you know, artists have always been working with some sort of data. You know, we have our kind of natural receptors, our eyes, our ears, our hands. You know, these are our ways of seeing the world naturally. And then from that, those kind of inputs, then we've kind of found different tools, be it paintbrushes or sculpting tools, in order to kind of express that data we have collected. And we kind of output that data through our human lens, through our kind of through our own way of interpreting the world. And as we have developed and kind of moved into the digital age, our tools have obviously moved much more into the digital world, and our data sets, our ways of seeing the world, are not just limited to the receptors we have with the human body. We can see macro data, we can see huge kind of epochs of time that obviously we'd never have been able to see before. We can see data from under the sea, from space. So kind of, I guess, as an artist, it's kind of, how do you then use this data in order to see the world in a new way, kind of embody that data, and then output that in a whole series of different ways. And I guess the tools to output that data can be digital, or you can output that data as obviously within this project with Wayne McGregor. Wayne McGregor outputted that data as dance. So we kind of have a whole series of different tools and you know, things that we can kind of work with at the moment. So the project with Wayne McGregor had been working with Google Arts and Culture for some time to create an algorithm that was able to create AI generated choreography. And what that did, that project, it analyzed all of Wayne's archive over about 25 years and analyzed the video, and it learned how to dance kind of from the language that Wayne McGregor had created for over the last 25 years of his career. And then he worked with that data, the output from the tool that was created, to generate new choreography. So the new choreography was created in collaboration with the tool. And then I guess for me, the way I worked with that data, Wayne called me up and he said, would you like to work on a project for me for a performance in LA of some of the kind of experimental work he'd been creating in collaboration with the tool. So obviously I said yes. And then I went to Google Arts and Culture Lab in Paris, spent some time with them. And I said to them, can you give me like half an hour of AI generated choreography that's been created from the data set of Wayne's work over a period of time. The tool, the new tool, not a hammer, not a paintbrush, not this, the new tool that Google created in order to generate this choreography. And then what I did after this with the code from that, with Google Arts and Culture, hijacked that code and kind of output it in a whole series of different ways. So, you know, as a person, we only have a kind of arms, legs, and, you know, our body to express ourselves with. So, but obviously using digital means, I could output that in a whole series of different ways. So we could see dance and see movement in a whole spectrum.
Fantastic. And I'm really interested to see this work. I presented Wayne and commissioned Wayne in the 90s. When I was a dance presenter, so I've witnessed his evolution from the very beginning. And because what always fascinated us at the very beginning is that his work emerged out of his own physicality, out of his own body, which he then gifted to other dancers, and over time that's evolved. So I'm curious to know whether the AI has managed to pick that up and make sense of that. But should we have a look at the work? Let's see it play.
How is it that we could work with machine learning or artificial intelligence to amplify aspects of the process that allows us to do things we could never have done before? It started, first of all, with a trip to the lab in Paris to meet Damien and his team. And it was amazing, that first conversation, because it was really exploratory.
We explore with artists and cultural institutions the intersection of art and technology.
So when we started working with Wayne, we were really interested about movement prediction.
We had to gift the archive, and it was a huge archive, you know, it was thousands of hours of video to be analysed. For that tool to work, you have to have a body, first of all, inspiring it. It was phenomenal we were able to have this performance in LA. What was interesting to me is once we'd gone through this process and we were building these phrases of movement, we were building these packages of choreography, is they inherently look different from things that we've made before. This was a technological marriage, if you like. It was that we were working together to inspire something really new. Ben Collar-Williams is an artist I've worked with several times before, and when I realised that I wanted to find some other translation of the archive in another discipline, I felt Ben would be the ideal collaborator for that.
This project was very fascinating for me because it was a brand new type of collaboration. Having the chance to work with AI to create a brand new piece of abstract video, we made that movement interact with a whole series of different environments.
Now the archive is going to be open to the public. So all of this private stuff that we've done to generate this new piece of choreography is going to be blown open and anybody can access it.
We made an online experiment, which is really a fun way to navigate through this map using your body.
It gives you an atlas or a map of all of the moves in the archive. You get a sense in which there are hundreds of thousands of unique moments of movement. So movements that never used to go next to one another are all of a sudden next to each other, and you click them together and make a little phrase of physical action, and you can play it, and now you have a unique version of a phrase that nobody else has ever made. It speaks to this idea that everybody has the opportunity to see movement uniquely, and everybody can actually make choreography.
Amazing. So Ben, we can find that on Google Arts. Is that right?
Yeah. So you can go onto the Google Arts and Culture experiment, and you can see the project that Wayne made with Google Arts and Culture, and then alongside that, you can actually see the process that Google Arts and Culture and myself, how we work together. We work together on a Google Chrome platform, and we created these kind of different environments. We fed the code into it. So it was all made through Google Chrome, and you can actually go on to those kind of experiments and you can kind of play around with different parameters that we put on there in order to change and manipulate the different dance code. I was just gonna say, like, for me, the most interesting thing about that was the choreography, the AI generated choreography that was kind of outputted from it. It was the kind of, some of it was very kind of, I guess, traditionally beautiful stuff, sort of stuff you would naturally see as, okay, that's kind of really kind of appealing dance. And some of it was like super ugly and kind of weird and strange. And my natural inclination when making the video installation was kind of to edit these bits out. But I was like, I've got to stop myself and I'm going to leave those in. Because those kind of things that AI will do, the things that will kind of knock us sideways and be able to think us in different ways, are the things that don't privilege our own human lens. We have to kind of treat AI as a kind of equal if it's going to kind of stimulate progress and stimulate change in order to get us out of our kind of preconceived habits.
Thank you. I mean, there's lots of links to be made across everything that you're saying, but sort of linking back to Patricia's work and that reinterpretation of the body and giving us the opportunity to almost get inside of a physical entity. And just thinking about what Mike said about bringing people together is so important in our world, and the interactivity of this project is incredible in giving people the chance to really get under the skin and get inside work and understand it from a completely different perspective in a way that I wouldn't even have imagined would have been possible in back in the day when I was presenting dance before any of these new forms were even invented. So really, really interesting. I'm going to move us back to Mike And we're going to have a look at your film and understand a little bit more about the really interesting work that you're doing with Culture Counts to use data in creative ways, but also in very hard ways of driving business practice and opportunities for businesses to reach their goals. Shall we see the film and then we can...
Yes, please.
...a wee bit about... how you've approached that.
We work with vulnerable people, people who experience disability or disadvantage, and enable them and empower them to take part and excel in the arts. When we took part in Culture Counts, what it actually gave me is much more than I thought, because what it looks at is the artistic vibrancy, the social impact, and the organisational ability of how the project is delivered. So it's those three key areas which I get phenomenal feedback on.
With our work with Culture Counts, we were able to consult with an external body on what would be good current relevant questions to ask. How are we going to benchmark our organisation against other organisations in the arts or other disability organisations?
What Culture Counts gives, it gives the external evidence this is making a difference to these people's lives. People can also see...
Mike, do you want to just come over in and just talk a little bit about that particular project?
Yeah, this was one of the early organisations who adopted the Culture Counts platform. It's a organisation in Queensland that works with people with disabilities. It's obviously a participatory practice that they have, and they used the platform to measure the impacts that the participation of their clients had on their socialisation and their engagement with community, and then use that information to apply for grants and basically validate their achievement of their mission. I chose that because A, it was a video that I had ready to hand, but B, that it demonstrates the holistic impact that arts and cultural activity has. It's not just the cultural impact of cultural activity that matters, and it's not just the audience perspective that matters. It's a very participatory way of viewing the world, and that that we saw, I thought that was a fantastic way of engaging participants digitally, with the ability to choreograph the different aspects of a piece of dance work. So it's just a snapshot of the work that we do, where we work with local authorities, we work with place managers, we work with arts and cultural organisations to explain the holistic, the social, the cultural, the community connection aspects, and the cultural and economic aspects of all different types of artistic work. And of course, yeah. Culture Counts is being used in England at the moment for a very specific purpose with Arts Council England, which we can perhaps talk about more if we have time.
Yeah, and measuring value is fundamental to everything that everybody's doing in the room, being able to